Good day, ladies and gentlemen. My name is John Frable Parker, and I'd like to welcome you to a program dedicated to Herman Melville, the author of Moby Dick, and to Luis de Camões, renowned epic poet and author from Portugal. In today's program, written by Maria Fernanda de Andrade Liphardt, we will try to uncover some information about the life of Herman Melville, so closely tied to Albany's own history and culture, and see what actually went into his works, which are so important to American literature. In the second part of the program, we will also look at the works of Luis de Camões. We will try to see how his works have influenced the works of Melville, and how the Portuguese culture and the American culture, how Portuguese literature and North American literature are intertwined. These programs, this is the fourth in the series, have been created for Albany Public Library's Foreign Language and Culture series. The four programs which I've mentioned have dealt with Portuguese culture and at times their influence on American culture. In addition, we have done other programs about German, Spanish, Polish, and a variety of other cultures. We hope you enjoy today's program and will continue to watch the programs done for Albany Public Library. Sit back and enjoy, and we hope you will learn more about Albany's own culture and our literature from this country. Thank you very much.
Of all the literary figures born in New York State, perhaps none is closer to the hearts of Albanians than Herman Melville, the father of the American epic Moby Dick. Herman Melville, born on August 1st, 1819, in New York City, was the third child of Alan Melville and Maria Ganzevoort Melville. His mother, of Dutch descent, was the only daughter of General Peter Ganzevoort, revolutionary defender of Fort Stanwix. His father was the second son of another revolutionary officer, Thomas Melville, a descendant of Scottish nobility who had been an Indian at the Boston Tea Party and who inspired The Last Leaf, the poem by Oliver Wendell Holmes. In 1830, Alan Melville's importing business failed, and he moved his family to Albany. His son Herman became a student at the Albany Academy until his father's death in 1831. Young Melville had a variety of jobs. He worked as a bank clerk, a helper on his brother's farm, and as an assistant in his brother's fur factory and store. From 1835 through 1838, he continued his education at various high schools and supplemented his family income by teaching. In 1839, difficult economic conditions at home made him work his way to Liverpool on the St. Lawrence, a merchant ship. In Liverpool, he noticed the crowded streets, the poverty of much of the population caused by the seamy side of the Industrial Revolution. This must have affected him deeply. In his later works, Israel Potter and The Paradise of Bachelors and The Tartarus of Maids, he shows a concern for the common man, the white working class, subjugated to the factory overlords as the slaves in the South were subjugated to the plantation owners. Melville returned to the United States and in the summer of 1840 traveled to Galena, Illinois, searching for fortune. Fortune did not smile at him, and in 1841 he embarked as a sailor on the whaler Acushnet, bound for the South Seas. He jumped ship in the Marquesas Islands, where he lived among the natives for about a month. After a series of adventures, he traveled home on the frigate United States. His first book, T.P., was published in 1846, followed by Umu in 1847. The same year he married Elizabeth Shaw, daughter of Chief Justice Limo Shaw of Boston. In 1849 he published Mardi, followed by Redburn, and in 1850 White Jacket. Arrowhead, a farm near Pittsfield in Massachusetts, was bought the same year. He began an influential friendship with the writer Nathaniel Hawthorne, who lived in nearby Lenox. In 1851, he published his most famous book, Moby Dick, followed by Pierre in 1852, The Piazza Tales, and The Confidence Man. With a wife, two daughters, and two sons to support, and like many authors of his day, he became a lecturer and wrote poetry. In 1863, he sold Arrowhead and moved with his family to New York City. In 1866, a collection of his poems was published. His son Malcolm died of a self-inflicted gunshot, and his second son, Stanwix, ran away to sea. 10 years later, a long poem, Clarel, was published. In 1886, his son Stanwix died. Jean Mar and Other Sailors was privately printed in 1888, followed by Timoleon in 1891. Melville died September 28, 1891. A small group of friends accompanied the body to Woodlawn Cemetery. Only one newspaper carried an obituary notice. The first publication of Billy Budd, his last novel, occurred in 1924. Melville slowly disappeared into obscurity after the 1850s, and some considered his move from New York City to Pittsfield in 1850 as a conscious effort to isolate himself from the American literary culture of his day that he found superficial and devoted to commercial success rather than serious work. Melville drew on his own experience and on his imagination to create his unforgettable characters, and his style was influenced by Shakespeare, Sir Thomas Browne, Camões, the Bible, and the magniloquent oratory of his time that also influenced Walt Whitman and Mark Twain, the style of manifest destiny. His style is considered to be quite different from the conventional writers of his time who worked in the style of Edison and Johnson. Tall tales, comic mythology, folk heroes, the revenge of the frontiersman upon the New Englander, those are some of the motifs that influenced Melville. However, our concern today tries to focus on another area, perhaps less known to the general public, the one related to Herman Melville and the Portuguese-speaking world. This connection was influential in many of the books he wrote, but particularly in Moby Dick. Moby Dick that has been called far more of a poem than a novel, an epic, a long poem on a heroic theme. It is in Moby Dick, his best novel, and the one he took longer to write, nearly 2 years, that the presence of Luis de Camões, the Portuguese epic poet, is felt more deeply. Others have pointed out that Camões has influenced not only Melville, but other American English writers as well, such as Lord Byron, John Milton, Wordsworth, and Elizabeth Barrett Browning. Both Camões and Melville have much in common, not only in the events that shape their lives, there are striking similarities in their biographies, but also in shared spiritual values and character traits. Their works show a great affinity in thematic construction as well. We will talk about this later. Now our concern focuses on other works by Melville, perhaps less known, but quite relevant to those interested in Melville's Portuguese connection. First of all, we would like to comment on the book White Jacket, Melville's fifth book, written in the summer of 1849, as related by his wife, Elizabeth Shaw Melville. The novel took approximately 2 months to complete, and it was written in New York City. White Jacket portrays the life on deck of an American man of war on its cruise from the port of Callao in Peru, around the Horn, back to its own port on the eastern seaboard. The symbol that gives the book its title, the White Jacket, was concocted out of an old duck shirt and designed to protect the owner from inclement weather, the ship, the Neversink, would encounter round Cape Horn. It was a garment that brought ridicule on the wearer's head. When an accident plunges its owner into the ocean, he gets entangled in it and almost drowns. He manages to cut himself out of the jacket with a knife. The jacket disappears into the deep, and its owner is saved. Melville did possess a white jacket that was probably discarded into Boston Harbor, as he related in his correspondence. In the summer of 1849, Melville traveled to London, hoping to make arrangements with Richard Bentley, his English publisher, for White Jacket. He met with Bentley on November the 12th, but as he could not obtain a cash advance, he decided to call on other publishers. After 6 unsuccessful tries, He met once more with Bentley on December the 15th. The publisher agreed to give Melville not a cash advance, but a £200 note. February 1st, 1850, White Jacket, or The World in a Man of War, was first published in two volumes in London. The first printing of the American edition came out later in the same year. The American and the English text were not identical. Melville had some changes made, perhaps during the voyage, perhaps while waiting to see Bentley in London. Melville, in need of economic help for most of his life, wrote the novel for money, as he confessed on a letter to his father-in-law, Judge Lemuel Shaw. However, he acknowledged that the book represented his true feelings. "I have not repressed myself much, but have spoken pretty much as I feel," he wrote to the judge. The novel is based on Melville's experiences during his 14-month service aboard the United States, an American frigate. Melville served from August 17, 1843, to October 14, 1844. While the writer spoke disparagingly of his other previously written novel, Redburn, and referred to it as a little nursery tale of mine, he felt differently towards White Jacket, which has been considered one of the most carefully put together of his novels. He used his own experience, but also drew from many other sources to write this book. Many of the characters he created, Captain Claret, Shanley, Mad Jack, Surgeon Cuticle, those could have been actual people Melville had met, but he also added some invention of his own. However, for those interested in the Portuguese connection, none is more relevant than Jack Chase, captain of the main top. Jack Chase was actually John J. Chase, a native of England, 53 years of age, whom Melville remembered affectionately through all his life, and to whom he dedicated another of his novels, Billy Budd. To Jack Chase, Englishman, wherever that great heart may now be, here on earth or harbored in paradise, captain of the main top in the year 1843. While there are no extraordinary characters such as Ahab or Ismael in White Jacket, there are a great number of characters who are portrayed with great vividness, and above all, much of Melville's own feelings are brought forth. Melville, characteristically, was a kind-hearted man. During a trip to London in the fall of 1849, he made this entry in his journal. "Coming home with Davies, I was struck with his expressions concerning the poverty and misery of so large a portion of the London population. He revealed a heart." Melville also had a heart, and White Jacket is basically a voice against the cruelty of war, the authoritative naval discipline, and the evils of flogging. The final chapter eloquently summarizes Melville's own desire to see such cruel punishment abolished forever. He had seen 163 floggings in the 14-month time he spent on the frigate United States. It has been said that the book had an influence on Congress, and flogging was abolished September the 21st, 1850. Melville wrote in a letter to a friend, "I am offering up the vowed jubilations for the abolition of the flogging law." Just as flogging was horrifying to Melville, so he felt towards war. In the book, he quotes Article 4 of Articles of War. It reads, "If any person in the Navy shall pusillanimously ask for quarter, he shall suffer death." And he stresses that the Articles of War hold out no reward for good conduct, but only compel the sailor to fight, like a hired murderer for his pay, by digging his grave before his eyes if he hesitates. It has been said that the owner of the White Jacket was Melville. The alienation he suffered, his search for self-identity and final rebirth, when he is pulled out of the water and the jacket disappears never to return, can be tied with Melville's own search for self-identity. In June of 1851, he wrote to his friend Hawthorne, "Until I was 25, I had no development at all. From my 25th year, I date my life." Herman Melville, at his 25th birthday on August the 1st, 1844, shortly before the frigate United States entered the Rio de Janeiro, the Bay of All Beauties, so idyllically described in White Jacket, and of so much relevance for those interested in the Portuguese-speaking world. Some of his critics claim that the chapter describing the Bay of Rio de Janeiro is not appropriate to the story, but Melville was a great admirer of it. In a letter to a friend, he called it the most glorious sheet of water in the world. Most interesting as well are the references that Melville makes of characters and scenes depicting Portuguese, Brazilian, and Cape Verde nationals, Brazilian scenery, and, as we have previously mentioned, the Portuguese epic poet Luis de Camões. Let us focus first in Jack Chase. Jack Chase, an ardent admirer of Camões, could recite parts of the Lusiada, Camões' immortal epic, in the original Portuguese. Melville appreciated Jack Chase's knowledge of foreign languages, and he mentioned Charles V, who was fond of saying, "He who speaks five languages is as good as five men." Melville's granddaughter Eleanor Melville Metcalf tells us that her grandfather did not know foreign languages and was known to have a defective ear. In several instances, Jack Chase quotes from the Lusiada, "For the last time, hear Camões, boys. How calm the waves, how mild the balmy gale, the ocean's call. Eulogian spread the sail, appeased old ocean, now shall rage no more. Haste, point our bowsprit for yon shadowy shore. Soon shall the transports of your natal soil overwhelm in bounding joy the thoughts of every toil." Jack Chase greatly impressed Melville. In White Jacket, he calls him "my liege lord, captain of my top, my sea tutor and sire, ever noble Jack Chase, matchless and unmatchable." Jack, a lover of the sea as Melville was, the sea so well described in Camões' Lusiada and subsequently by Melville in Moby Dick, Jack tells White Jacket, "A sniff of the sea, my boy, is inspiration." And he directs the young boy to admire the sea scenery and calls his attention to the moonlight on the waves, the dawn with the east flushed with red and gold. Once more he recites Camões, "With gentle hand, as seeming off to pause, the purple curtains of the morn she draws." And Jack Chase with delight calls Camões Commodore Camões. Later on in the novel, he tells White Jacket that he sailed the very track that Camões had sailed, round the East Cape into the Indian Ocean, and furthermore, he had been to Macau and visited the cave, a Gruta das Lágrimas, Grotto of the Tears, where Camões wrote certain parts of the Lusiada. This Englishman, who could charm the young Melville with Portuguese poetry, should perhaps receive a greater than normal share for influencing Melville's later works. In White Jacket, chapters 24 through 26 and 28 refer to the approach to Cape Horn. Cape Horn, as well as the Cape of Good Hope, have been symbols of sheer terror of the ocean and the mighty forces of nature that try to annihilate man. In the Lusiada, Vasco da Gama, the discoverer of the sea route to India, engages in a dialogue with the giant Adamastor. "So deep a gloom the lowering vapor cast, transfixed with awe the bravest stood aghast." And the giant shows himself to Vasco da Gama with words that Melville used in White Jacket. "In me the spirit of the Cape behold, that rock by you, the Cape of Tempests named." William Julius Minkle, the English translator of the Lusiada, wrote in his notes, "The fiction of the perition of the Cape of Tempest, in sublimity and awful grandeur of imagination, stands unsurpassed in human composition." Melville was well aware of Camões' description, the terror of the ship's crew confronted with such awesome sight, and makes Whitejacket remark, "Who has not heard of it? Cape Horn, Cape Horn, a horn indeed that has tossed many a good ship. Was the descent of Orpheus, Ulysses, or Dante into hell one whit more hardy and sublime than the first navigator's weathering of that terrible cape?" Melville comprehends the symbolic significance of Camões' sonnet when Whitejacket concludes, "But sailor or landsman, there is some sort of Cape Horn for all." Chapter 56 refers to the visit of the Luso-Brazilian Emperor Dom Pedro to the frigate. Some curious sociological observations can be noticed. Whitejacket remarks upon the jewels and brilliance of the Emperor and of his Luso-Brazilian retinue. Whitejacket calls them sons of jewelers all, who had run away with their father's cases on their backs. This Brazilian and Portuguese love of pomp and finery has been noticed and mentioned by several writers. The French writer Piard wrote of the Portuguese living in Goa, then Portuguese India, during Camões' lifetime, and he tells of many Portuguese small noblemen and poets who had enlisted in the army. They had but a small income, which forced them to leave 9 or 10 to a house in order to make ends meet. Not only in living quarters was their condition modest, but in clothing as well. When they chose to go for their daily stroll, they could only leave the house 3 or 4 at a time, because they possessed no more than 3 or 4 silk suits. When they left the house regally attired, accompanied by a slave carrying a parasol, they cut quite a vision of wealth and pomp. However, they had to hurry home to give the others a chance for a walk. As soon as the first group returned, quickly a change of clothes was made, and the second group could finally parade in style. Camões described this story in his Redondilha, "a um fidalgo que lhe tardava com uma camisa galante que lhe prometeu," to a nobleman who was late in coming with a fancy shirt that had been promised. And his epigram, "Quem por abas me quer conhecer," which translates as "Who wants to know me by my lapel," refers to the same episode. It is more likely to believe that the noblemen waiting on the Luso-Brazilian emperor possessed their own clothes, as opposed to the penniless poets serving the Portuguese crown in Goa. But the inhabitants of Rio de Janeiro must have bedazzled the young Melville, and he chose to mention them in his novel. He demonstrates to know Brazilian lore when he mentions that Dom Pedro carried in his chapeau a single feather of the imperial toucan. He explains that toucan feathers once formed part of the regalia of the Indian caciques, and upon the establishment of the empire, were symbolically retained by the sovereigns. Not surprisingly, perhaps, Melville lets the reader know that he is too democrat to show too much deference towards the royal heads. He makes Jonathan, a young New England sailor, make derisive remarks towards royalty, and even Jack Chase remarks that every man who has a sole to his foot has a crown to his head, the crown at the top of his head. Perhaps to emphasize his feelings towards nobility, he places the Marquis of Silva, one of the emperor's attendants, in a rather comic situation. He makes him trip over his sword and fall. Pomp and circumstance did not impress Melville. It is perhaps curious to observe that in his later books, Pierre and Israel Potter, Melville would set the tone with florid dedications that mock the nostalgia for royalty shown by the heirs of the American Revolution. Melville liked to undermine aristocratic pedigrees per se by recalling their inglorious origins, bastardly in the case of the vast majority of English families deriving their titles from Charles II, no very fine fountain, and usurpation in the case of the minority descended from the Norman thief knights who had wrested the English throne from the Saxons. The sole aristocracy to which Melville accords any legitimacy is the American Indian aristocracy, violently dethroned by the white colonialists of the New World, as he makes quite clear in his other novel, Pierre. Portuguese port and Madeira wines are frequently mentioned in White Jacket. Captain Claret, as his name seems to indicate, was rather fond of these wines. We also know that Melville appreciated them. His friend Nathaniel Hawthorne mentions that Melville kept excellent port at home. Reference is made of a Portuguese sailor, the sailor Antonio, who suffered flogging because of a fight aboard ship. Another Portuguese seaman breaks another man's head after being harassed by a mob during skylarking, a sort of mad carnival that developed aboard ship when the captain wanted to force physical exercise upon his crew in frigid weather. Melville, a New Yorker as well as a Massachusetts man, was well acquainted with many Portuguese who were active in the whaling industry. Many of these Portuguese were from the islands of Azores and Madeira. New Bedford had a section called Faial, after the Azores island, known for its eerie crater of the extinct volcano Caldeira. The Acushnet, Melville's first whaling ship, had carried a crew of 21 Americans, one Englishman and four Portuguese. Life was very harsh aboard those whaling ships, and the Pacific, so named by Magellan, the Portuguese explorer, was what we would call a sweatshop. Many of the men deserted, and Melville himself was a case in point. He deserted the Acushnet, his first whaling ship, at the Marquesas. He was one of 11 mutineers aboard his second, a Sydney ship, the Lucian, at Tahiti. Nothing is known of his conduct on the third, except that he turned up after it ashore at Honolulu. Knowing what we know about whaling, perhaps Melville's desertion can be well accepted. The whaling voyage is frequently extended over a period of 4 or 5 years. The ships were infested with rats and furnished with worm-eaten provisions. Many men suffered from venereal diseases. In TP, one of Melville's autobiographical novels, the hero begins by trying to explain what drove him to jump ship on a cannibal island 15 months after setting out on his first whaling voyage, choosing rather to risk my fortunes among savages than to endure another 4 years under a captain whose word was law and against whose ill treatment there was no redress. And the protagonist adds, the usage on board was tyrannical. The sick had been inhumanly neglected. The provisions had been doled out in scanty allowance, and the ship's cruises were unreasonably protracted, and attributes these abuses directly to the captain, whose conduct was arbitrary and violent in the extreme, and whose prompt reply to all complaints and remonstrances was the butt end of a handspike, so convincingly administered as effectually to silence the aggrieved party. In White Jacket, there is also mention of a small musical band from the Cape Verde Islands. These hardy Cape Verdeans were also very much visible during whale hunting days. Many of their descendants still live among us. Melville chose to portray the Cape Verdeans in the G's, a flippant sketch of 2.5 pages, printed on March 1856 in Harper's Monthly. The G's tries to discredit the racial theories of ethnologist Josiah Nott and his popularizer Samuel Cartwright, who wanted to prove that the Negro was distinguished by inferior intellect and a physical affinity to the lower animals. The G's derived their name from a contemptuous abbreviation by seamen of Portugal, the corrupt form of Portuguese, and it relies on satire as means of exposing the absurdity of Nott's racial theories. It parodized the format and style of the ethnologist's treatises on the Negro, while striving to describe a curious race Melville encountered in his sea goings. These G's were the inhabitants of Fogo, one of the Cape Verde Islands off the West African coast. Fogo, a volcanic island with a barren soil, never could feed properly its people. The American whalers, aware of this fact, formed the habit of touching at Fogo to fill up vacancies among their crews. The menace of starvation in Fogo and the lure of food aboard ship were enough to attract G's sailors in droves who were willing to accept the lowest possible wages. Perhaps Melville's early relationships with Cape Verdean sailors and the natives of Polynesia made him free of racial prejudice. Belief in the brotherhood of man seems to have been one of his aspirations, as the reader is made aware when White Jacket is communing with Tony, the black sailor in the main top. Melville's attitude towards race relations is clearly exemplified in a lecture written in late October or early November of 1859. In it, Melville tells his audience that travel serves to get rid of a few prejudices by counteracting racial stereotypes. In this lecture titled Traveling, Its Pleasures, Pains, and Profits, Melville emphasizes his personal beliefs. He writes, "The Spanish matador, who devoutly believes in the proverb, cruel as a Turk, goes to Turkey, sees that people are kind to all animals, and comes home to his bullfights with a very different impression of his own humanity. The stockbroker goes to Thessalonica and finds infidels more honest than Christians. The prejudiced against color finds several hundred millions of people of all shades of color and all degrees of intellect, rank, and social worth, generals, judges, priests, and kings, and learns to give up his foolish prejudices." And Melville adds that the legitimate tendency of travel is to teach profound personal humility while enlarging the sphere of comprehensive benevolence till it includes the whole human race. And he stresses that the necessity of submitting to the persecutions and extortions of guides abroad may open the eyes of the American traveler to the thousand times worse extortions practiced on the immigrants here. And Melville, on his own drives from Pittsfield over to the paper mills at Dalton, as well as a frequent visitor to his father-in-law Boston residence, must have been also made aware of the textile mills of New England, where thousands of immigrant workers toiled under subsistence wages. In many of these mills in Massachusetts, particularly in Fall River, thousands of Portuguese men and women labor under unhealthy working conditions, and many contract tuberculosis. It is perhaps relevant to point out that Melville's father-in-law, Judge Limon Shaw, Chief Justice of Massachusetts, was the man who, among 100 contributions to legal thought, had rendered the first really decisive opinion favorable to trade unionism. White Jacket, the G's, bring to us much of Melville's philosophy and the richness of his experience and knowledge. For those among us who are interested in the Portuguese-speaking world, these works are doubly relevant. The Portuguese influence, and particularly Melville's fascination with Camões, will be brought forth in Moby Dick. Melville had a lifelong fascination with Camões and had access to the Portuguese language and culture very early in his life. The Cushnet, Melville's first whaling ship, had four Portuguese in a crew. Three were seamen and one was an officer. Two of the men could not read or write since they signed their names with a cross in the ship's log. But the officer could have taught Melville Portuguese and awakened in him an awareness of Portuguese culture. Melville's granddaughter, Elizabeth Shaw Metcalf, tells us that he did not speak foreign languages, but in the book White Jacket, there are a few elementary Portuguese phrases of greeting during the Brazilian emperor's visit to the Neversink. Furthermore, Melville must have heard Portuguese spoken aboard the whaling ships he served from 1841 to 1843. We also know he possessed a copy of Camões' lyrical poems. The book is annotated with passages both in English and Portuguese, marked. John J. Chase, the Englishman he met aboard the frigate United States during Melville's homebound journey, knew Portuguese poetry and often recited parts of the Lusiada, the Portuguese epic poem. Melville greatly appreciated Jack Chase, and he dedicated his novel Billy Budd to him. Melville was devoid of racial prejudice at a time when many of his contemporaries and friends held dim views on the abolition of slavery. The 1850s were a bleak time in the United States for racial equality. Slavery gained a new impetus under the pro-Southern regime of Franklin Pierce. Melville attacked racial prejudice in many of his works, often resorting to sexual innuendo. Beneath the Sereno, The Confidence Man, the relationship between Ismael and Kipig in Moby Dick are a case in point. The G's, a sketch he wrote to Harper's Monthly, ridicularized the racial theories of Josie Arnott. At times, Melville's concern for human values outweighed the intellectual affinities he felt with members of the Pittsfield Society. One was his Pittsfield neighbor, Oliver Wendell Holmes, who cherished memories of slavery in its best and mildest forms, passed to him by his slaveholding grandfather, and he Melville portrayed as a hearless scientist in I and My Chimney. The other was Hawthorne, who wrote a biography of Franklin Pierce, the president who served the interests of slaveholders. Hawthorne, who wrote that it was sentimental nonsense to risk American lives in order to liberate slaves. Melville wrote that Hawthorne seemed to feel a touch of a shrink on encountering my ruthless democracy on all sides. And his novel Mardi would contain his first literary protest against slavery. Perhaps his early whaling days close contacts with the Portuguese, a race that has been called a global race, a race that embraces the entire world and who intermarries freely, as well as his stay among the Polynesian natives, perhaps have influenced his moral values and guided his pen. Many are, therefore, and from many sources, the Portuguese influence on Melville's values and literary creations. However, perhaps one of the most significant is the one that emanates from Luis Vaz de Camões' The Lusiada and its relationship with Melville's epic Moby Dick. We will refer to this relationship in the later part of our program. First, we would like to call the attention of our listeners to the striking similarities in the biographies of these two authors. While Herman Melville's place of birth is well known, Luis de Camões can only be guessed. Some place it in Lisbon, some in Coimbra. The date of his birth is tentatively set at February 5, 1524. However, some claim it as January 27, 1522, early in the morning. Both men were the product of aristocratic families. Melville's mother was a descendant of the Genzevorts of Albany, and his father was a revolutionary officer. Camões descended from small nobility, poets from Galicia, but some dispute his Galician origin. We know he was a distant relative of Vasco da Gama, the discoverer of the sea route to the Indies in 1497. Both Camões and Melville suffered an unhappy childhood, marred by poverty and by the early death of their fathers. Melville's father died, beset by economic problems, when he was only 13 years old. Camões' father drowned off Goa, the former Portuguese enclave in India, in one of those naval expeditions that claimed so many lives. As young men, they were drifters. Camões was banished from Lisbon after his play, the piece El Rei Seleuco, offended the Spanish-born Queen Catarina. He became a soldier and went to North Africa, to Ceuta, the ancient Roman scepter occupied by the Portuguese, who hoped to control the trade overland from the Red Sea to the Moroccan coast. In Ceuta, he lost his right eye. Melville, after a series of odd jobs and a short teaching career, traveled to Galena, Illinois, in search of fortune. Serious economic need at home, his mother's letters to a brother reflect a desperate struggle to feed and house herself and her fatherless children, forced him to seek fortune elsewhere. He embarked on a whaling ship, the Acushnet. Camões, who deeply loved this country, was likewise forced to become an exile. Military service was his escape avenue, and after 6 months of hardship, he arrived at Goa. We know what the whaling voyages were like, the meager rations, the lack of health care, the long hours the men were forced to work, the despotism of the captains. Not surprisingly, Melville deserted the Acushnet, his first whaling ship. On the second, the Lucienne, he became a mutineer and was imprisoned at Tahiti. Camões, and just as repulsed by his surroundings as Melville had been among the whalers, embarked on expeditions to local kingdoms, trying to protect his country trade routes. Forced to be a soldier, he disliked war. In the Lusiada, he would write, "On brute cruelty and bestiality, do you bestow the names of valor and of bravery, and hold possessed of virtue great him who despises human life, life ever to be prized, for he who gave it shudders at its loss." Melville shared with Camões a dislike for war. In White Jacket, he would explain why a man of war was created, to sink, burn, and destroy. His description of the Battle of Navarino and of the sea fight between the United States and the Macedonian is said to bring home his own ironic duplicity. Melville allows his hero, Jack Chase, to celebrate war by driving the point that war is an evil. In 1866, he would write Battle Pieces and Aspects of the War. In this piece, he reveals his tension between two moral positions, his commitment against slavery, and the reversion he felt against the tragic waste of human life during the American Civil War. Both Melville and Camões suffered the influence of two men who made a great impact on their lives. During his stay in Goa, Camões met and was befriended by Garcia Dorta, a physician and botanist, the first writer of tropical medicines and their uses. The first poem ever printed by Camões was included in Garcia Dorta's treatise, Colloquios. Likewise, Melville would find in his friend Nathaniel Hawthorne companionship and inspiration. "This Hawthorne has dropped germinous seeds into my soul," he wrote. Hawthorne's sympathetic reception of Moby Dick was acknowledged by Melville. He felt Hawthorne to be a divine magnet to whom my magnet responds. After Hawthorne's long stay abroad, the two meet again in 1856 in Liverpool. But the magic was gone, and Melville's poem Monody is considered to be Melville's obituary, both to Hawthorne and to their friendship. After a life dedicated to literary pursuits, fame and glory evaded both men. Melville slowly disappeared into obscurity after the 1850s. Unable to obtain a consular position and in constant need of money, he lived on the generosity of Judge Limo Shaw, his father-in-law. In his last years, he worked the dull routine of a customs inspector. Camões, upon his return to Lisbon, tried to have the Lusiada published. The work appeared in print in 1572, and Camões was granted a pension of 15,000 reis by King Sebastião. The pension was paid uncertainly, causing the poet to live at times in dire financial circumstances. In his last years, sick and disappointed, he suffered with the social and moral deterioration of his countrymen. King Sebastião's ill-fated expedition to Morocco had ended in disaster. 8,000 men were killed in battle and 50,000 carried off to slave markets. Only 50 men escaped to bear the news to Lisbon. The king's uncle, Cardinal Henrique, was 66 years old and died without an heir. Philippe II of Spain entered Portugal and claimed the Portuguese throne. For the next 60 years, Portugal would be involved in Philippe II's foreign wars, the Portuguese navy would be destroyed, and the spice trade lost to other European powers. In his last years, Camões grieved over his country's ills. No more of muse, no more. For now my lyre is out of tune, and my voice grows faint. I weary not of singing, of folk whose ears are deaf to song, and whose hearts are hard. That one gift which fires a poet more than all, my country will not grant. Sink in greed and avarice, in ignorance and gloomy vice, morose it lives content. On June the 10th, 1580, Camões died from the plague, poor and neglected, without even a bed sheet to cover him. Melville's poem Camões, written late in his life, bemoans the neglect shown to the Portuguese poet by his countrymen, and reveals in the process an awareness of his own estrangement from the public. Camões, therefore, remained a living force in Melville's literary creation until the end of his life. Melville died September 12, 1891. A small group of friends accompanied the body to Woodlawn Cemetery. Only one newspaper carried obituary notice. Most American literature scholars and literary critics have ignored the importance of Camões in Melville's personal and creative life. The link between Camões and Melville was acknowledged only in 1950. As we have previously mentioned, nowhere is this influence more evident than in Moby Dick. The first complete Portuguese translation of this novel occurred in 1951. The book's organizing structure is said to be closer to an epic than to a novel. It can be defined as an epic because it reflects a vision of the cosmos rendered through the ideals expressed by a group representative of a particular race or nation. The crew of the Pequod is composed of men of many nations, and as such, it can be considered as representing all humanity. The Lusiada tells the noble deeds of the sons of Lusus, the legendary ancestor of the Portuguese people, from the beginning until Camões' time. Much of the Lusiada is recited by Vasco da Gama to the king of Malindi on the East African coast, while events that took place after Vasco's departure from India are presented as a vision and prophecy revealed to him. The voyage described in the Lusiada, as well as the one in Moby Dick, are symbolic voyages whereby a group of people embark on an adventure of discovery, which is also a quest for an understanding of man's destiny. The chase after the white whale is a superhuman adventure that will test human valor, much like the Lusiada narrated discovery by Vasco da Gama of the sea route to the Indies, a feat where the courage of his countrymen is put to the test. There are striking similarities in the organizational structure of these two sea epics. Unlike the prescribed exalted note of affirmation at the end, the two epics end in a negative, somber note. Ahab drowns attended by a silent god. Camões laments the inner defeat he finds among his countrymen upon returning home from India. Perhaps to emphasize Camões' influence on Melville, the Pequod's itinerary changes. Instead of circumnavigating the Horn, it follows the course taken by Vasco da Gama on the way to the Indies, around the Cape of Good Hope, through the Indian and Pacific Oceans, covering the extent of the Eastern world, known at the time of the Portuguese poet. Both authors make use of epic similes. A gleaming polar star is compared to Ahab's fixed purpose of finding the whale. Ahab is compared to an elm. It highlights the phonetic significance of St. Elmo's fire, one of the ominous sea signs that will bring a premonition of disaster. Camões mentions in the Lusiada the Moluccas, Malacca's Peninsula, Asia's most southern point, Sunda Island, Sumatra, Timor, Pactolus, a river in Lydia famous for the gold washed from its sands. All these names are mentioned in Moby Dick. Both Camões and Melville mention the biblical legend that called the Solomon Islands fear. Both authors mention the birds of paradise, the bird that never alights, because the merchants who brought them for sale in Europe cut their legs. Hydra, Argo, and Cetus, the southern constellations, are mentioned in both works. William Julius Mickle, the English translator of the Lusiada, had included in his translation, read by Melville, an essay in which he discusses the cavern pagoda of Elephanta in India. Melville refers to this cavern pagoda when he describes Cetus, the sea monster he sees as precursor of the whale. Both men mention Pythagoras when alluding to metempsychosis. Contrary to classical prescription, both authors digress extensively, Melville on the whale industry and on the whale's anatomy. Camões incorporates into the Lusiada long segments narrating Portugal's past. Several interpolations are also made by the author-narrator in both epics. They are authorial intrusions, usually made as personal confessions or ontological observations. Melville often ends the chapters with reflections regarding man's plight on earth. At the end of chapter 7, the chapel, there is a reflection upon the smallness of man before the eternal mystery. Methinks that in looking at things spiritual, we are too much like oysters observing the sun through thick water and thinking that thick water the thinnest of air. Similarly, Camões, at the end of canto 1 of the Lusiada, comments on the lot of man. By land, what strife, what plots of secret guile, how many a wound from many a treacherous smile. Oh, where shall man escape his numerous foes and rest his weary head in safe repose? Another structural device common to both is the insertion of a shorter narrative within the frame of the larger one, a narrative within the narrative. In Moby Dick is the town hall story, and the Lusiada is Magrisu in the 12 of England. The town hall story highlights the function of the whale as a great leveler, while the Magrisu episode gives proof of Portuguese gallantry and service to the cause of love. Both Camões and Melville interfere as authors in the narrative and assume the role of narrators. Similarly, in both the Lusiada and Moby Dick, the apparent heroes must yield the importance of their characters to others. Vasco da Gama must yield his prominent place as protagonist to the whole Portuguese race, while Ismael loses his narrative stature for the sake of Ahab's prominence. Both epics share another structural parallel, the prophet. In Moby Dick, Elijah prophesies the ship's doom and Captain Ahab's death along with that of the crew. In the Lusiada, we note the venerable old man of Restelo, who warns Vasco da Gama and his crew of the dangers that lie ahead. In this manner, the reader is made aware of the superhuman tasks and of the temerity involved in defying the gods by going where no man has ever gone before. Impending doom is foreshadowed by land features and sea phenomena as the Cape of Good Hope, the spirit of the Cape, the spirit spout, St. Elmo's fire. All these elements are to be found in Camões de Lusiada or are introduced by Mickle in his translation. We recall that Melville changed the Pequod's itinerary. Instead of circumnavigating Cape Horn, Melville's route when he sailed on board the Acushnet, the whaler sails for the Cape of Good Hope, where Melville had never been. The Cape of Good Hope was where Camões had originally located the spirit of the Cape. The spirit of the Cape, also mentioned in White Jacket, Billy Budd, and the Encantadas, is for Melville what Camões had intended it to be when he creates the giant Adamastor in the 50 canto of the Lusiada, something huge and horrendous. Moby Dick does not make direct allusions to the spirit of the Cape while circumnavigating the Cape of Good Hope, but the significance of the chapter, the spirit spout, can be better understood if one recalls White Jacket facing Cape Horn in the legend of the giant Adamastor in the Lusiada. The sea phenomena that appears in Camões' epic poem, the water spout and the corpo sans, described by Vasco da Gama, before the Cape's crossing, are incorporated in Moby Dick, along with the spirit of the Cape, as signs of impending doom for the crew of the Pequod. In the Lusiada, the spirit of the Cape is the giant Adamastor, the lord of the seas. He wants to possess Tethys, princess of the waters. Tethys favors the Portuguese, who have shown courage in battle and faith in the power of love. Vasco da Gama is now free to sail unknown waters where no man has been before and find the sea route to India and to the Spice Islands. The spirit of the Cape is evil, is Satan. Adamastor dared to rebel against the gods and was punished by Jupiter, who had his limbs turned into stone. He is like Ahab, who also defies God by his committed pursuit of Moby Dick. Both men loved the sea and had a feeling for nature. Their descriptions of land or seascapes are said to be accurate and picture-like. Both their works reflect the vastness and mysterious spaciousness of the ocean and share a fear of the unknown. They use nautical metaphors as well. Ismael's Meditation and Water are wedded forever, or the ocean is an everlasting terra incognita. Human beings are seen by both authors as weak before the indifferent forces of nature, and death is ever present. Land is seen as more dangerous than the ocean, and men are considered to be more dangerous and treacherous than the monsters at sea. The Island of Love, said to be inspired by the island of Madeira, located 530 miles southwest of Portugal and discovered in 1419 by two Portuguese, is referred to by Ismael in Moby Dick. Camões had written the episode of the Island of Love in the Lusiada. Some suggest that the Island of Love indicate Camões' belief that paradise exists in the love between man and woman, free from social conventions. Both protagonists are saved and tell the story. Camões is shipwrecked, but manages to save the manuscript of the Lusiada, and Ismael is saved by holding two boards from a coffin. There is therefore a symbolic rebirth in both epics. The writer Pedro Gonzalez Blanco declares that the geniality of a writer is not only revealed by his or her work, or by the perfection it employs, but also by the acceptance of the general public, simpatia social. While Camões' mythologic Renaissance style and Melville's 19th century style have been overpassed, the majestic prose, the high seriousness, the language which moves along rhythmically, swaying the reader into experiencing and not just visualizing the reality described, make the poetry of the Lusiada and the prose akin to poetry of Moby Dick timelessness.